Lust is not a sin, biblically speaking, but covetousness is. And my music video in the description below, linked, tackles this disparity between the Greek word epithumeo and the concept of lust as one of the seven deadlies, the seven deadly sins. There isn't parity, and the devil's in the details of centuries of false equivocations between those two. In other words, the Christian concept and the biblical word are correlated, but one is inherently illicit, while the other is not only sometimes licit, but commendable sometimes. And the fulcrum around which the difference revolves is the context, but more specifically the object of the epithumeo, the strong desire. I once stood beside preacher Paul deParrie, called the Portland Porcupine, the late Paul deParrie. As a high school girl was going around, he was preaching at the outside the high school on the public sidewalk, and this girl was going round and round in circles, arguing with him for a long time in Portland, talking about how, oh, young people just need to have sex. We just really need to have sex. How badly young people want to have sex. And in exasperation, Paul deParrie, the Portland Porcupine, he used to wear all black and a French resistance cap. And his black was the way Johnny Cash would wear black in mourning for, with Johnny Cash, it was for the prisoners, I think. But for Paul deParrie, it was for the little babies killed by abortion. So Paul deParrie is this big, big man with a beard, dressed all in black, and in exasperation, she just kept going, we need sex. We young people need sex. He said, sweetheart, in exasperation, get married, then you can hump like rabbits, day and night. I think he said bunnies. Get married, then you can hump like bunnies, day and night. And he's right. So I encourage you to watch my video below. The world is, in case you haven't heard, from Elon Musk or any of the other people who have been talking about it lately, overpopulation is not only a myth, it's an inversion of the reality. The world is facing imminent demographic implosion. God made the sex drive, and it's dangerous. The sex drive is dangerous, like a car or a pistol or any other, you know, very dangerous but potentially useful, you know, weapon or tool. You know, it could possibly even be compared to nuclear power. But it's not inherently sinful. It's inherently good, unlike, arguably, nuclear power. Maybe I shouldn't have used that as a comparison. So it's not inherently sinful more than another natural appetite, but it is probably more dangerous than some of them. So in a society that's drowning at this point in access to the raunchiest porn is at the fingertips of basically anyone, even children here in sub-Saharan Africa, where I am at this moment, who don't even have electricity in their houses, are using, you know, car batteries to charge up a phone and look at porn in the outhouses. And their teachers have told me that when I have been speaking at with teachers at church in rural communities in Africa. And this is pouring out of America. Let's get real. There was, in the decade I was born, in the 1970s, California was still criminalizing porn. It was on an episode of Dragnet, okay? It's not like it was ancient history. Sergeant Friday was busting rings of pornographers. So we could still do it, even with the internet. Give the policemen something to do instead of harassing us for our free speech rights and harassing Donald Trump and harassing Christians. Of course, that's mostly the FBI, not really the local police, but fine. Let them do it. Let them bust these people. It's not like you can't identify the actors. You can see every mole on their bodies. So in scripture, epithumeo can be strong desire for food, for knowledge, for sex, for holy things. for godly ambition. It can even be a description of, Jesus used the word to describe his own desire for the Last Supper, to break bread with his disciples on the night on which he was betrayed. So it's a moral, utterly morally neutral word, can be extremely, and it's translated sometimes as lust, and occasionally in King James's covetousness, but it's confusing, very confusing, and it's caused confusion in a lot of young men, young people, who have been falsely led to see their libido as inherently illicit. When it's not, it's very dangerous. It very easily goes in an illicit direction. But it is, in fact, aside from the fact that we are inherently sinful, and we tend to sin, but the libido itself, any more than the appetite for food, is not inherently illicit, as evidenced by the word. And if you bring in, there's 16 instances in the New Testament of epithumeo, but a whole lot more if you include the, if I'm not mistaken, if you include the Septuagint, the Greek scriptures. So, when the Lord said that it's adulterous, and mind you, he said the specific word for adultery. When people like Ray Comfort walk out to people on the street and say, "Hey, my friend, you're a sinner." And they say, "I'm a sinner? How? Have you ever looked upon a woman to lust after her in your heart?" And they say, "Oh, yeah, I have." That is really a false application of that passage. That's not what Jesus is saying, that everybody who desires. Now, it very easily, and probably most of the time, goes in an illicit direction. But the desire of a man, the libido of a man, to sleep with a woman is not inherently sinful. And Christians have collaborated, hopefully unwillingly in most cases, or ignorantly, but collaborated with the devil in setting a huge trap for people at the same time when we've decriminalized pornography, setting a huge trap, especially for men who are so visually, easily, turned on, so that men of God that we need as warriors to fight for the kingdom of God think that they're utter failures. Think they've utterly failed as Christian men and are disqualified because they can't, well, they weren't supposed, unless they're called to a life of celibate chastity and so gifted, as Jesus said, they're not able, okay, to do that. And so it's a perfect storm of universal, ubiquitous access to raunchy pornography, okay, this bad exegesis of the word that's translated lust in the Bible. And then on top of all that, 100 years, more than 100 years of feminism, more than 100 years of feminism that has made westernized women, I mean, you'd rather cut off your arm than be married to one of them. It's miserable. It's, welcome to purgatory. Okay. I mean, it's almost to the point where rather than marrying a feminized, even the ones in the churches who think that they're traditionalists, 9 out of 10 of those are so bad, so assertive, so, without even realizing it, so destroyed psychologically, so unqualified to be wives. So go for these Filipinas, men. That's the way out. Stop rewarding them. Stop giving them your money. I mean, the westernized women. Stop it. Stop it. They're not worth it. To the point where you can feel sorry for men and understand why they're preferring pornography and their hand to being married to these less than useless, negative value bitches that we've cranked out through our utterly, I mean, talk about a culture. And culturing things. If Western culture was a jar of mayonnaise, I don't think you could find a dog that would touch it at this point. So anyway, I digress. But Christians have made a terrible mistake demonizing the male libido as though it were inherently sinful. And when Jesus said, look at the passage, look at the Greek, when he said it's adulterous in the heart to look on a woman with strong desire, epithumeo, he's not talking about the desire. He's not demonizing the desire. The sin is not in the desire. The sin is look, the desire for a woman It's not in the lust. It's in you're looking on a gune, a married woman. He's not using the word for a single woman that you could marry. Now, you can commit sin looking at her, too. You can desire to fornicate or use her like a prostitute. That's evil. Okay? But people are reading that wrong. He's talking about the Pharisees who are looking at their neighbor's wives and say, as long as I don't touch her, I can lust after her and probably masturbate, too, is what I think is the clear implication. And he's telling them, hey, look, these things, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Okay? So is he. And we've turned that into this, like, masochistic idea that we're imposing on all the young men in a scenario where they're not even being protected, like the law should be protecting them by criminalizing pornography. So this perfect storm where they're just thrown to the hyenas and their self-image is destroyed, and they think that they're just these utterly evil people when really they've been utterly provoked by a perfect storm of, you know, give the devil his due. This what Western society has devolved and degenerated to is a satanic masterpiece. I mean, that's, you know, the devil has, is quite an impressive fellow in that sense that he could, and I don't even blame him completely. It's people who have let this happen. But the problem isn't the men and their libido, especially these young men who have grown up in this horrible scenario. As much as it is those of us who are middle-aged and older who have allowed this trap to be sprung on them, and we've set it for them by refusing to organize, to criminalize, and prosecute the pornography, among other things. So it's Strong's, if you want to look it up, don't take my word for it, number 1937, epithumeo, pronounced epithumeo, and the words used 16 times. I'm not going to go through all of them. Matthew 5:28, Matthew 13:17, all the way down to Revelation 9:6. Sometimes negative, sometimes neutral, sometimes extremely positive. The point being, it's not the lust, it's the object.